It's really great to be back here. It's been a long time, but I'm really excited to say that I'm bringing back a lot of wonderful information. It's wonderful to see so many faces, and that is really very pleasing to me because that lets me know that the things that I've taught and the things that we share together that you've actually been able to apply. So I want to congratulate you and you to congratulate yourselves for really doing so well and valuing the things that I've shared with you. So thank you so much, and clap for yourself. We're going to talk about something very, very important today. My associate, Dr. Mona, has brought you up to date about the importance of water, and we're moving into some very, very intense times. But I'm very excited about these times because I, as a surgeon, never believed that the human body was to age, to die, and that we had to permanently remove parts and really leave people afflicted and with significant deficits. My intent as a surgeon was always to first do no harm, and because I've been devoted to that oath, it has really propelled me to do tremendous exercises in thought and interpretation and most of all research of the medical literature to really bring forth finally wonderful answers to know that you can actually be whole and healthy. I've been talking for years about immortality and regeneration, and still to many of you it may seem far-fetched. But I do want you to know that you have the capacity to be on this planet for a very, very long time. So it's going to be real important to recognize that you can create a quality of life that you look forward to every day, or it can be a literal hell for those who haven't really put the effort in. But longevity is something that is literally promised to us. I'm concerned about what is going on, and as I have always been dedicated to is making sure that the woman understood what her environment, what society is really asking of her, and what is really being offered. So many of you have heard about the stem cell research and genetic engineering and tissue regeneration and implant, transplant. It's just gone on and on and on. But are you really clear, and do you really understand the history of what momentarily is being asked? Right now in the news, in our medical journals, et cetera, there's a real big inquisition, literally, about the legitimacy of using embryos, the legitimacy of using stem cells, et cetera. We've had questions about the use of our blood, our tissues, et cetera, but what has really happened? And today, I really want to share with you very clearly so that you can understand what your present and your future is asking of you is what is really the issue here with a science that is known as human corporeal reengineering. So simply abbreviated, it stands for HCR. Corporeal means of the body, just like we talk about the Marine Corps. Okay, we're actually talking about a body of. So we're talking about re-engineering of the human body, human corporeal re-engineering. So we have my slides been turned all of a sudden. Okay, great. Let me put it out here for you so that it can be very clear. I want you to have this correctly spelled, okay? I'm going to lay my slides here. So I have a little story to tell because I want you to really understand the history of the issue we're dealing with, because many of you may think this is a new issue, but it really hasn't been a new issue. It's been a suppressed issue. And all people, all races have been affected. And that's why we have to really come to this issue about who we are and how valuable our tissues are and what value do we have on our physical bodies, each and every one of us, because we all have been affected. So let me tell you a very interesting little story. Does everybody know who that individual is or was? okay? Again? That's right, okay? And, you know, he's going to help me today shed some light on this subject because even he has been abused by his own colleagues as much as he gave to science. So I want you to stay with me and read with me. I wanted to make this very clear so you can get it. So let's look at the story here of Albert Einstein. The history of Dr. Einstein is that he died of a ruptured aortic abdominal aneurysm. And so if you know what the anatomy is, there's a big long tube that actually sends blood back up to the heart. We call it the aorta. Many times if you lay on your stomach, if you're very svelte, you can see it pulsate or you can actually feel it. Well, that got a weakness in the wall, kind of like a hernia, and under pressure, it ruptured, and that allowed him to make his transition on the 18th of August. His body was cremated at his request. His ashes at his request were scattered in an undisclosed location. He did not want any type of shrine. He didn't want a museum. He didn't want a memorial. He was a very private man, and he felt that his private life should be kept to himself. Einstein's family assumed then, once they cremated the body, spread the ashes where he wanted to be disseminated at his request, that his entire body had been cremated and that they had carried out his will. The truth, however, is that a doctor by the name of Thomas Stoltz Harvey, who was a pathologist on his case at the time of death, and his body was taken to the Princeton Hospital. This was a place that he had been seeking treatment prior to his death, conducted Einstein's autopsy and removed his brain and kept it, okay? Without Einstein's permission, Dr. Harvey took the brain, sliced it into 170 pieces, numbered charts, and each chart was actually kept in congruently with each piece to be able to follow the location, etc. And each piece was prepared for microscopic evaluation and was actually examined under the microscope. Now, since that time, Dr. Harvey has controlled who has had access to Einstein's brain tissue. 12 scientists were given slices by Dr. Harvey as gifts. Dr. Harvey had easily access to Einstein while he was alive to obtain permission for the specimens. It was actually documented in his medical chart that he had been sent by the hospital to actually even draw blood from him and could have gotten obtained consent from Dr. Einstein prior to his death if this had been something that he really wanted to do in an honorable manner. However, he did not use the opportunities and at the time of his death seized the powers at hand and actually took his brain. So the question here is why and how does Dr. Thomas Harvey or any other pathologist have a moral or legal claim to dominion over a patient's tissue? Individuals like Karen Ann Quinlan's brain, Herbert Humphrey died of cancer of the bladder. His bladder was actually taken. And both of these were published studies that were shared with physicians like myself in the New England Journal of Medicine. Truly, these individuals did not give consent to medical society to take their bodies, and especially their disease organs, and use them as case studies. For the past two centuries, people's bodies and tissues have provided inquiring researchers with sometimes useful and sometimes useless information about the people whose tissues were taken. In relationship to their illnesses and behaviors, these were also aspects of study, and we're going to look at this later. Often the targets of research are chosen because of their membership in groups or by races, such as the extensive research that has been done on the Native American Indians for alcohol, tuberculosis, and for cirrhosis of the liver. Africans and African Americans and Asians have been studied to elucidate racial differences and similarities. also Racobacteria. Now, this is very important because now Dr. Bodice hit upon this, and I want to bring that subject full circle. The AIDS virus has been documented as what we call a Racobacteria. That is to say that it was genetically engineered to affect only certain races. So as Dr. Bodice has shared with us, that the virus was engineered to actually explode when it came in contact with AZT. The virus was also created to only be activated in the vaginal mucosa of African women. So, to the Lactobacillus virus, and they discovered that in different races, the Lactobacillus virus in the vagina either moves or doesn't, which we call it either motile or it's actually stationary. Uniquely to the African woman, her Lactobacillus is mobile. And so therefore, with this virus attached to it, at the time of the menstrual cycle or at the time of intercourse, because there are small little breaks in the mucosa of the vagina that do happen at intercourse, that this then allows this virus to be passively but actively taken into the bloodstream of the African woman where it then becomes activated. We do also have records that are documented in our medical books that the Ashkenazi Jews were used, their blood was used to determine why so many of the young children, especially male children, died in infancy. And this is when we discovered that they had an enzyme deficiency, which did not allow them to metabolize properly amino acids. And to this day, babies are still tested for PKU via their urine. Also for Tay-Sachs disease. Serial killers, all of their blood and tissues are actually taken for analysis. And this has actually been recorded in many of the psychological studies. Gay men are under intense study now. Their specimen, there's a whole book entitled The Sexual Brain, where Dr. LaVey took upon himself to take the brains of homosexual men, measure them and analyze them and look at the superficial contours to determine the similarities and the dissimilarities between heterosexual men and males and females. The book is quite revealing and very interesting because he did show something that is very important and I think that all women need to be aware of. His conclusions were interesting, but it's very clear that men who are heterosexual, the brain is quite different than that of females and quite different than that of homosexual males. The homosexual male brain appears to be very similar to the female brain. It does not enlarge in size. It does not take on the normal contours of a mature androgen, or as we should say, a testosterone infused male brain. As far as race studies go, this is a very interesting series. It comes out every 4 to 6 years, which is a collective group of researchers around the world that collaborate on different subjects. And there's a known group and organization that do nothing but do research on melanin. So melanin is known as the melanotropic peptide. When you see the structure, because it's quite complex. But they publish, as I said, once every 4 to 6 years, the three-volume series here at the time in 1995 cost $650. And so if you were not a contributor, then you had to pay to get it. So I bring this to your attention to let you know that obviously the millions of samples that were used from individuals who were melanated around the world, they did not receive free copies of the result. And obviously they were not notified about the results, and those who wanted to know about it obviously had to invest in the information. Again, there have been many studies done on comparison of Caucasians and Africans in America, and this was a very interesting study when I came across it. It was actually published at, it was actually done at the University of Houston here, I think, in Texas, University of Texas, the pediatrics department, where they actually took blood from Africans and African Americans and trace the correlation between how many genes were present in African Americans as opposed to their original ancestry from Africa, and then also traced the incidence of miscegenation as to how many Africans could actually demonstrate Caucasian genes that have been incurred into the African race in this country over the last 200 years, and what the effects are. Because as you see there, it says the measure of non-African ancestry is difficult, but it is worthwhile for several genetic reasons. And it's very clear right now that when you begin to see what's going on with genetic engineering and human tissue re-engineering, et cetera, to understand the combination of genes and the effect that it has sociologically, physiologically, is quite important when we decide what tissues or what source of specimen is needed to create the most ideal tissue for this particular part of the body. Again, lifelong differences in hemoglobin levels between blacks and whites. And I've really tried to make this really known amongst my colleagues, is that medicine has to evolve into a science, really, that I call human ecology. It's very, very clear that each race cannot be standardized on one race's standards. And this has been a tremendous problem here in the Western world and has been held steadfast for many reasons. And I tell my clients it's very important to understand that if you are an African or African descent, we can only really evaluate and determine your health based on your standard. We cannot use Caucasians, we cannot use Asians, etc., and vice versa for them. So as a gynecologist, it's always so interesting to see how many African American women are immediately put on iron pills, are immediately diagnosed as having anemias and other problems because the standard that they are compared to is that of a Caucasian woman. So therefore, when we look in our office at the blood studies, we have to really reinterpret them because the standard for all blood chemistry in this country is based on Caucasian blood chemistry. So understanding and having done the research, we know what the differences are. Obviously, they know what the differences are, but they have never been discriminated into the hospitals and into the clinics that take care of these diversified races. So there are many surgical procedures, there's many diagnostic studies that have been done to know if they are for no reason, because the individual literally was fine. But he was actually being forced to measure up to a standard that was never his or hers. And mind you now, this study was done, as you see here, this came out in 1975. Okay, so we've had ongoing problems. The question here is, and this is something that you have to be clear about from this point on as we move forward into this century, is do you have legal authority over your tissue fluids and contents, your blood, your organs, or your body parts once they are removed from your body or after your death? So even when I was in my residency, all the placentas were gold to the hospital because they were sold for $300 each because they were sold to cosmetic firms or their resources, etc., and were used for cosmetics, and if the patient had pathology, then also they were used and taken immediately for research centers. I used to always wonder why so much blood needed to be put in each tube and why so much blood was being taken when we literally do what we call nanometer extractions to measure chemical contents in the blood. But yet and still, the vials were always full. And we know that we can do a complete blood count on less than a cc of blood. So why do we need 10? But as you have seen these studies, if you read them in detail, they talk about tens of thousands of specimens. Some of these studies have 100,000 specimens. That is that 100,000 children, 10,000 men, 15,000 women have participated in this study. How did they get these samples? They were actually taken from the hospitals to the medical institutions, analyzed for these reasons, with your name, with your age, with your birth date, et cetera, on it, where they could actually grade date them and put them in the proper divisions so that they could make accurate conclusions about what it is that they wanted to find out. I'm sure most of you have never ever given consent. You never ever knew that you were in these studies. You had no idea that other than the test that you agreed to with your physician that your blood was going anywhere. So you can only have control over something that you are aware of. So it's not only you going to the doctor and they asking you to sign consent forms, it also is having them make commitments to you about what your tissues and your specimens are going to be used for. And as far as I'm concerned, I feel that they should also sign that and it should be recorded in the chart. But you'll see why as we go further. Now, this is very interesting, and I want to bring this to your attention, because you're going to have to decide if you just want to still use an institution to heal yourself with, because you still are lacking information about understanding how divine and how awesome your own tissues are. This came out in 1999, and this came out of Scientific America. They did a whole series on the bionic future. And so this was actually preempting all of the different markets that were going to be available for us in the new millennium as to how we could actually re-engineer our own bodies. This is very interesting here, and I really wanted you to have the whole pages. This is a theoretical question. Is it theoretically possible to engineer organs such as livers, kidneys, breast, and intestines? And it's very interesting because the answer is yes, it is. What they have found out is that once they decide what tissue they want to use as the inoculum or the source to actually grow the organ, because we have to have seed tissue, there's some things that they had to become aware of. Here I'm showing you where they talked about something known as specific molecules that were needed to either inhibit or to enhance tissue growth. And also too, this process is known as angiogenesis. Angio means arterial or vascular. And anytime they grow tissue, they have to always make sure that it has a way of feeding itself, so they have to be able to stimulate arteries and veins. So with these new substances that have now been discovered, where they can actually create on demand a circulatory system in any cell culture, okay, they can control how much these cells reproduce and bring about a cessation of their reproduction, they were in business to know that they could now grow new organs. So it's very interesting here. Let's just read this very quickly. It says an exciting new strategy is poised to revolutionize the treatment of patients who need new vital structures. The creation of man-made tissues or organs is known as neo, which is new organs, okay, neo organs. In one scenario, a tissue engineer injects or places a given molecule, such as growth factor, into a wound or an organ that requires regeneration. These molecules cause the patient's own cells to migrate into the wound site, turn into the right type of cell, and regenerate the tissue. And this happens in seconds. So they now know, have timelines on how long it can take to basically regenerate your organs. What do you want? Well, it's interesting. People have been sampled, and we recognize that there are races and groups of people, their age, et cetera, neglect of their body, that they actually want to rebuild themselves. Well, they know that they can use the templates from muscles, very healthy muscles from individuals who have wonderful muscle mass, and they can regenerate or give you the injection, and your muscles will actually increase in size in a matter of 2 to 3 months, significantly, almost up to 50 to 60%. So it says here that regular exercise can slow the decline quite a bit of muscle atrophy, and the rate of loss varies from person to person. But still, if you manage to be a healthy septuagenarian, which means if you're in your 70s, et cetera, chances are you will have lost at least 20% of your muscle mass, and perhaps even up to a third. So if you want to have muscles again like you were in your late 20s, You can literally go shopping. Now, if you're looking at this, if you're looking at the story as I show it to you, it's very clear that all the specimens that they are using are African or African in descent. And this magazine is quite unique in that it normally is not race specific because it normally only contains Caucasians. So this was a very unique magazine in that this was the first time in my life, and I've taken this magazine for over 10 or 12 years, that the entire magazine was showing African physiques, African structures, etc. So it never said that the specimens were actually going to be African, but it did say that, okay? Now, this is very interesting, and women, I do want you to pay attention. Let me move the strip here. Now, I don't know how many billions of women in the Western world literally have hysterectomies, but I definitely know way over 200 million. And I'm quite concerned about the very cavalier and casual attitude that's taken by surgeons in removing tissue, because literally their cavalier attitude has now created a tremendous market where tissue engineers have now been busy recreating implants to replace these organs. So the question is, do they really need to come out from the beginning? And secondly, the information on how you can regenerate your own tissue has never been shared with you. Look at this. So it says here that this doctor, Dr. Atala, is a tissue engineer whose idea is to grow transplanted organs from a patient's own cell. Now, I want you to listen to this very carefully. Now, they were able to identify the fact that a bladder and a uterus were not very different, and that by asking the tissue to actually make just a switch in the part of the DNA that's going to be activated to make a bladder versus a uterus, that they could actually take the cells, create a bladder, and this is what you see, a bladder that can easily be transformed into a uterus. So it's already said here, if you read at this point, where it says, Atala wants to create a uterus that can be transplanted into women who are born without one or who have uterine abnormalities or scarring. Now, the incidence of women being born without a uterus is like almost 1 in 500,000 women. It's very rare that we come across an agenesis of the uterus, as we would call it. So it is not financially feasible to create an industry that a disease so rarely occurs to do this. So that is really not what the issue is here, because the market is that if we have over 200 million women with hysterectomies, that is an instant market, where if this is actually solicited properly, that these women will basically now want to have a transplant of the uterus. It is no secret that women that have hysterectomies know that that is not the ideal state they would like to be in, but they tolerated that state because this is what was told to them, et cetera, and because of the stress of the disease that they had at the moment. You can get uteruses, bladders, and of course, you can also get heads. So, hair transplants are available. I do want you to know this because it really forced me to have to look at the social criminal aspect of what's really happening here. So many people disappearing, people never reappearing. I was looking at what was happening in the 70s with the individuals who had no homes. All of a sudden, instantly, America was cleaned up. There were no homeless people. Well, where are they? Well, I will let you do the research, but I'm quite clear where many of those bodies went to. Now, my colleagues and I have already taken the first steps toward human head transplantation. Let me remove the strip because I want you to see this. Okay. My colleagues and I have already taken the first steps toward human head transplantation. We have developed pumps and devices to lower to 10 degrees Celsius or 50 degrees Fahrenheit the blood circulation to the head that is being prepared for transplantation. Such cooling slows metabolism in the brain so that its blood supply can be cut off for up to an hour during surgery. The greatest hurdle is remaining is how to prevent the body from rejecting the new head and vice versa. It's unclear at this point whether the drugs now used to prevent rejection following transplantation of organs such as living kidneys, et cetera, and livers will work for the entire body. But the article goes on to talk about the fact that they have already been able to do this in chimpanzees, is that the chimpanzees immediately are conscious after surgery, are able to see, to hear, et cetera, and some of the chimpanzees have even gone on to get activity of the upper extremities. So the question here is that the transplant does work, but they have not been able to elicit mobility from the navel downward where they can actually get up and walk again. So now this was done over 2 years ago, so they go to work every day. So no telling what they've actually been able to do. Now, you know, this was something that I had been talking about for decades, that all tissue, not some tissue, not just the liver, not just your skin, not just your hair and nails, but all tissue can regenerate. All tissue, and I will say it again, all tissue can spontaneously regenerate itself. All tissue can spontaneously regenerate itself. So people are under the impression that, oh, I've had a stroke, I've had a head trauma injury, et cetera, that there's nothing that can be done because nerve tissue does not regenerate. It is not true. So here we have a study where they now have been able to state that new nerve cells do grow from adult human brains, okay? We do know that there are now actually herbal formulas and drugs now that can be given to massive stroke victims, and instantly these individuals can have full recovery from the stroke within 3 months. They even found that aspirin helps to decrease the amount of irritation in the brain and stimulate new neuronal growth. We're finding out, for example, as Dr. Mona has said, that even red wine helps to keep the plasticity of the brain, et cetera, and to ensure that the brain can continuously, just like the roots of a tree, sprout new nerve endings to continue to grow and expand. So I do want to bring it to your attention at this time that when they did look at Einstein's brain, they were very impressed with the fact that he had far more numerous nerve cells composing his brain than most people, okay? But this is something that was unique to him, but does not have to be unique to him. This is something that each and every one of you can create when you understand how the body works. Now, talking about regeneration, this is a little salamander, and they are actually showing that they cut the whole foot and arm off, or the leg off of the salamander, how it makes a little bud and then and over time totally regenerates itself. Well, this is the same thing that humans can do. And believe it or not, I'll show you later that humans are doing. But let's look at the next level of what is the problem, because tissue regeneration requires activation of the memory bank or the code to do so, known as the DNA. Now, this is very interesting, isn't it? Now, this was an advertisement in a magazine, and it says here, the gold rush. The bottom line is sure genomics holds out the promise of healthier lives, which means that they're going to be doing tremendous research on the genes, because this article says that we want to ensure that you can be healthier. We can find out where the gene is. It causes cancer, arthritis, all these things, et cetera. And we're going to be busy doing this. Again, this was in another scientific magazine that normally is monoracial in its presentation, except under these circumstances. So, let's look at what science really sees us as. So, this is wonderful copy. I love all these colors. But it actually is a collage that tells a story, because what it's actually saying is that here we have a state of consciousness, we have the egg of life, we have the sperm of vitality that comes together, and we finally get a being in this dimension. So this is actually a fertilized an ovum here that is in a petri dish that has already been fertilized by the sperm. These are the little cuties, that I call them here, they remind me of little shoestrings. I always think of my shoestrings as a little girl when I look at chromosomes, you know, because they look like your shoes are tied. But these are your shoestrings. They do vary in different races. Every race does not have the same number of chromosomes. That's very important to understand, which is why there are also criteria and determinations of race based on chromosome content and number. Okay? So this is how they look, and we are known about some of these, the trisomic, you know, 21s for Down syndrome, the sex aberrations, et cetera, but this is how they look. And when we break them down into their chemical structure, they look like this. So this baby is actually sitting in his own analyzed, activated, and transcribed DNA. And so basically the nucleotide bases, et cetera, have been given a name, and the initials have been used, and this is the codon, we call it, that is used to determine each and everyone's genes. So the A is for adenine, G is for guanine, T is for thymine, C is for cytosine. And there's a very profound movie that came out, and if you haven't seen it, I hope you take the time to do so. It's entitled Gattaca. And most people did not know what Gattaca meant, but Gattaca is actually the lineage of these codons, which is significant for human DNA. So for human DNA, it has to be Gattaca, G-A-G-A-T-A, in sequence. And we know then that we're dealing with a human versus a cat or a rat or a dog, et cetera. Okay, but we all are composed of the same nucleotide bases. Now, the facts are that each of us possess 80,000 genes, a little more or less. Our genes possess hundreds to thousands of combinations of the chemical building blocks of, as I said, adenine, cytosine, thymine, and guanine. 3 billion nucleotides make up the 80,000 genes of our genome, and your genome is actually your entire genetic code translated. We possess the code CCTGAGG in one segment of our hemoglobin, and that's for normal hemoglobin. However, if the nucleotide base of adenine, which is the A, is replaced with a thymine, it should be an M, the resulting sequence becomes CCTGTGG, and this creates the genetic adaptation known as sickle cell. Now, I do want you to understand that I did change this because they want to say that it's a disease. It's a genetic adaptation. Okay, it does not create an anemic state. It does not create problems unless the individual deviates from their normal acid-base titration. And so Dr. Mona talked about if you're too acidic, if you're too alkaline, what will happen in your body. These individuals, when they become acidic, the cell takes on an abnormal shape. It cannot pass through the blood vessel, and therefore they have what's known as a crisis. As long as they can understand how to live, how to think, and how to eat, where they do not become acidic, they will never know they have the problem. So the environment in Africa, et cetera, the foods that they eat, the environment that they're in, the high oxygen content naturally keeps the blood alkaline. So therefore, they do not have problems. There's millions and millions of people walking around with sickle cell. But they're in Africa, they don't have a problem. The environment, et cetera, and their diet and their attitude supports them, so it's not an issue. It's when these individuals who do not know their genetic makeup come here, okay, and then take on a lifestyle and a behavior pattern that they are not physiologically primed for, nor psychologically primed for, and then the blood immediately takes on a rapid change. Okay? So, the blood tells all. Mormons in Utah keep extensive official genealogies and health information about their 1.3 million member congregation. The Mormons maintain an extensive collection of blood samples that, when matched with family and health histories, could be used to help identify particular diseases genetically. The Amish also maintain similar blood and family health records, as do the Mormons. Now, for my scientific colleagues, they immediately begin to exploit that because of the new gold rush, which is who can control and count and manipulate the genes of humans first. So when I put that sign up here, this gold rush, I'm not playing. This is the new gold rush. Okay, your DNA. So therefore, over 100 competing geneticists set up shop in Utah. It's like, okay, these people got all the information we need. They got family histories on record. They got blood specimens, et cetera. So all we have to go down here and get into this. And they did. So therefore, they started doing genetic studies. One gentleman by the name of Mark Skolich was one of the first to arrive in Salt Lake City in 1974. He made a life investment. 10 years later, his pioneering efforts paid off. He used the blood samples from the Mormon families and identified a gene that could actually cause inherited breast cancer. Now, that sounds very noble and wonderful, but look at what he did. Who owns your genes and your genetic information? Now, remember, this information was contributed by each member of the church for religious reasons. It was not for Mark Skolich to go down here and begin to do research for his own personal intent. But what he did is that when he discovered what is now called the breast cancer gene, he founded a company known as Myriad Genetics and patented the gene. Now, he patented the gene, and his patent created the following circumstances. No one can perform genetic testing for a mutation in the breast cancer gene without his permission. Myriad can charge what it chooses to doctors or scientists to test patients for the breast cancer gene because they have to get the template and everything from his company. No one can develop or employ a gene therapy for breast cancer without his company's permission. And Myriad has indicated it will use its control to forbid prenatal testing for breast cancer due to the controversial potentials for abortion. Okay? So I want to remind you that you do have control over any circumstance in your life, but you have to be aware of what has gone on before you and what you tentatively are looking at. So the probabilities here are this, is that you as a patient working every day and having monies removed out of your check for, quote, medical insurance, unquote, will be paying $3 billion of the cost of discovering these genes through your insurance and your tax payments. Congressionally approved human genome projects may most likely be unable to be an experience for those individuals who paid the $3 billion to make it happen. That these organs, et cetera, that uterus that you saw, they quoted some prices that were starting at $18,000 and up. Okay? So, now we move into a new issue, and here we are. If you haven't seen this before, this is basically how the delivery room looks at the time a baby emerges from the vagina. And so there we are, double clamping the cord with the intent of cutting it. We've become a little more modern now for hospital deliveries where the family is involved. The father can then cut the cord. But basically, this is what happens, and this cord has become very priceless, and the blood from it. So please buy this week's Newsweek and read it very carefully. This is the cover, literally. It talks about the stem cell wars, embryo research versus pro-life politics. And I think this is very important, what this gentleman has said here, is that miracles are available to occur on the tip of a pen. Banning research on embryonic stem cells, so says Gerhardt, could make a lot of people in the future suffer needlessly and maybe even die. But on the other hand, if we harvest adult tissues instead of embryonic stem cells, says Senator Sam Brownsback, we won't have to kill anybody. So you have to understand that it's been known that people have been murdered and killed. Things have happened to be able to get hold of their tissues. Okay? So, what is the value of this clump of cells? Another human or a new hope for the disease and the dying? Now, what is this that you're really looking at? Now, there's another hoax that's being played here on the consciousness of the world. And people are being misled to basically think that stem cells are a specialized cell, which they are, that are only in certain parts of the body. But I will say to you again that the body is so devoted to regenerating itself till every cell in the body literally is a stem cell. Okay, now you have to understand that if I want to make you pay for something and I want you to come to me to get it, I'm not going to tell you that little secret. The most potent stem cell that you have in your body is literally your blood. And that's been known. That research was done in the early 70s. So there's been little things that have been trickling out in the newspapers. For example, they did a little study and they named these individuals Frick and Frock. And they demonstrated, for example, that it may not be in your best interest to be so svelte and so thin, because they found that the individuals who were very svelte and thin could not regenerate tissues because they did not have what they discovered were stem cells in the form of fat cells to begin the regenerative process. And that they discovered that the individual who literally kind of had a pantry that had fat cells, that those fat cells would de-differentiate themselves back into the original red blood cells and begin to regenerate tissue in damaged areas. So we know that fat cells are also stem cells. Red blood cells are also stem cells. And I'm going to show you later how all tissue comes from the red blood cell, which the red blood cell is actually the mother stem cell. We do have libraries in the body, which is the stem cell. This is the multipotential cell that actually holds all of the genetic information without being impressed from past events. Now, that's very important. What I said is that this is tissue that has not been impressed with the history of your past events. That is what these little clusters are stored in the body, that they are only telling you are the stem cell. Every cell is potentially a stem cell, but this is the cell that has not been impressed with your past, these clusters. So let's look at how the stem cells work here. Very simply, we have an egg and a sperm. It fertilizes to produce embryonic cells. These embryonic cells now have multiplied because it's fertilized, okay, and there's an outer ring or covering that occurs. The outer ring goes on normally to make the placenta, and the inner ring is actually this cluster of library information in the form of DNA that does not have the impression of a past other than what the mother and the father contributed. So then the lab will take the inner cells and actually put them on a petri dish and begin to grow them, and with the proper additives can then direct the library, open up the DNA and activate the segments to produce organ tissue for skin, for nerves, for pancreas, etc. Okay? That's very important to understand. Normally, this would go on where the inner stem cells would then open up themselves, they would then reproduce, and then the library literally is shed and is available upon access, but via your consciousness, and this is not what you're being told. Now, we have these wonderful brothers. They're too cute. I love them. So these are the four brothers with heart, no pun intended, okay? And they basically have come together, so let me turn them this way so you can identify them. You may see them on the street one day. These are the individuals that really are telling a big secret. Because what they discovered was this, that they discovered that if they made a biodegradable mold and took a scraping out of your mouth and actually inoculated this mold or template with it, that whatever shape they made the mold in, that the cells would actually grow and make that organ. So, for example, they are able to make ears. This is a template for an ear. Your ear is removed for whatever reason. They can grow you a new ear from your own cells. Now, you have to understand this is very profound, because the key here is that these are still your same cells. These are the same cells that are on the body that engaged it in getting its ear cut off. Now, for those individuals who are walking around that still have not spontaneously regenerated their own ear, it is not because their cells couldn't do it. Because to this very day, that person could be taken to these individuals, have the inside of their mouth scraped, put on this template, and those same cells would grow a new ear. So why don't these individuals have new ears? Why don't the individuals have new legs and new arms, etc.? Well, we're going to talk about that, but it's not because the tissue won't do it. It's something else inside the individual that interferes with the activation of that spontaneous programming. And that's what they don't want you to discover, because then you won't be able to buy this, because you'll be able to do it on your own, okay? This is a trachea. This is actually a bone for a finger, etc. This is actually the substance that is used for the template. Any segment of your body that you need, they can actually grow for you in the petri dish, but from your own tissue, okay? So if your own tissue outside of your body can take directions on a foreign substance, then why in the world can it do it in your own system? Okay, yeah, good question. Now, again, this comes from one volume of a 10-volume of works from Dr. Shishima, where he devoted his entire life to demonstrating to you that the red corpuscle, which is the proper name for what we carelessly call a blood cell, is a totipotential cell. And it was with this understanding that the Japanese were actually able to totally regenerate themselves after experiencing severe radiation exposure from the bombs dropped on them at Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and be able to totally and competently destroy the economy of this country. Okay, so they got very smart. They never made peace. They just said, we just will beat you in another way. So they regenerated themselves. Normally it takes generations to overcome radiation exposure of the extent that they had. So in less than 40 years, okay, in 45, they dropped these bombs, and then by the late 1970s, they actually had control of the economy of this country. Okay, so how do these people actually put their skin back on, etc., stop puking their heads off, because that's what the radiation does, etc., and be able to be methodical enough to destroy, disarticulate, and destroy the economy of this country? And it is because they understood that the real totipotential cell was the red blood cell, and they understood that they had limited access to it because the food that you eat continuously makes red blood cells that renew all of the tissues in your body. So as we continuously talk about colon health, the type of water that you're drinking, it's necessary for you to be able to have control over those properties, because you are given three sources of tissue to regenerate yourself in one lifetime. From the maternal blood, from the placenta, from the yolk sac, and we've seen that. This is what we're talking about here, what they are calling initial stem cells. And guess what? An ongoing source of making these erythroblasts that then move into erythrocytes is from the digestion of food substances in your intestines. So I'm very concerned at this time where individuals are thinking that it's actually glamorous to have different flavors of Tums and Melanta in their person on the shelf, because these individuals are literally destroying the only source that they have after conception and after birth to be able to have unlimited capacity to renew their tissues and live indefinitely. With a destroyed digestive tract, your days are limited, because then you will have to then go into the market and begin to buy organs, because you will not have the original source of blood cells that are healthy and adequate enough to be able to make yours. So do you see this? The same blood cell that creates cancer and other diseases, the same blood cell that renews all of your other organs. But what makes this totipotential cell known as the erythrocyte turn into cancer, turn into tumors, turn into arthritis, turn into all these different things? And there are a couple of factors, environmental factors, the solvent, the what I call universal solvent known as water, and we'll talk about the third one. I do tell you it's very important that you have to have a consciousness and an attitude of personal rulership when you go into the hospital institutions, because they are seeing you as money. This is a normal, very common advertisement for a call for research grants. Did you notice they're paying $5,000 to be able to carry out, and you tell them what you're able to do. They do have a list of things that you can do research on. As physicians, as nurses, and they will pay you a minimum of $5,000 for the studies, which obviously you as the patient are the ones that are going to be studied. This is another advertisement even for medical students here. So they're asking even the medical students can be involved in this. So the whole hospital system is really alerted to seeing you not as an individual who may be in need for a relief of discomfort, but you are literally money, and your tissues, et cetera, or is a potential to perhaps get a new Harley Davidson for somebody or whatever else, et cetera. And you need to understand that there are long-term consequences. Now, I talked about the fact that there was one area that was just slightly spoken on earlier today, but really needs to be clearly understood. And even to the point now that you can buy muscles, you can buy bladders, uteruses, you can make fingers, ears, whatever you like. We also now can make children that have the attitudes, the personalities, and the behaviors that we like. So genetically now they know that personality, they know that states of emotions are also part of the DNA genome, and there's a whole science of engineers that are looking at identifying what are the genes that do carry behavior patterns, states of emotion, etc. Because this little article here is a whole scenario about how a man and woman are going to the genetic engineer to determine what type of personality and behavior traits they want their artificially inseminated child to have. So this is the key, and it's very important. I really recommend that you spend some time really studying your brain, really studying how it works, what part does what, etc., because this is the master chemistry lab of the body. Any chemical known to mankind, the brain can make. But the brain functions by the commands known as thoughts. And so whatever thought you have, the communication between the cells of your body and your mind, which is not physical, is through chemistry. And it's the brain's responsibility to translate every thought into a chemical analog that is then flooded into the bloodstream and then transmitted throughout every nerve in your body so that the cells can respond appropriately second to second, moment to moment, minute to minute, hour to hour, as to what you are commanding them to do. Because to the cells of the body, all of these thoughts and things are commands. They're directives that the cells are to try to their best ability to actualize. Now, again, any mind that actually has thoughts that translated by the body cause the body to undergo trauma is a chemistry that does not activate the library or the stem cells of that body to regenerate new tissue. That is why the same tissue that is taken out of that environment that was traumatized and put into a new environment where the chemistry of trauma is not there immediately begins to grow again. That's what the four brothers really have discovered. So we recognize then that anyone who has been in an accident, anyone that's had to have surgery, etc., if they are interested in regaining access to that tissue again, they have to undergo a mental, neurological, hematological cleansing. And once that happens, your tissues will be more than glad to spontaneously regenerate the tissues. But my colleagues as surgeons have sold you a bill of goods to tell you that if I take this out or if I put this in, et cetera, that you're, you know, good to go and nothing else needs to be done. So you accept that, and then you therefore continue in a state of degeneration and have shut down your library where you no longer spontaneously regenerate because you have not removed the neurochemistry of trauma from the blood. Do you understand that? Yeah. So therefore, these people wind up having one surgery after another because they're continuously deteriorating because the neurochemistry in the blood that occurred that created the original trauma was never erased. Never erased. But we can take that same person, whether they're paraplegic, quadriplegic, have hysterectomy, a bilateral amputee, and take and streak these plates, and their tissues will grow into the template that was on these plates. There's nothing wrong with the cells. The cells can regenerate. It is the chemistry in the blood that interferes with the activation of this segment of DNA, and it's known as non-histone protein. So anytime you go to someone and you know that you have a long-term disease and they haven't addressed your attitude and your state of consciousness, you should know right away that that is malpractice and you should look for somebody else that's going to give you a more wholesome therapy. It's not about you just taking pills for your arthritis or for your high blood pressure, etc. It's about what am I thinking that continuously causes my tissues to react in this way, and I want to figure it out and stop thinking this way so that I can purge my blood of this so my tissues can go back to normal. That's what you want to do. Now, Barbara Brown, she was awesome. She was an astrophysicist, and she could really not understand the difference between the mind and the brain, even though she knew they were different things. And she really, in her own way, through mathematics and sacred geometry, and through research, she did some very interesting, very benevolent research that she finally was able to make these conclusions. I will tell you the name of this book in a moment. It was taken off the market. It's out of print. It's very difficult to get a hold of it. A lot of this stuff, as I said, they take it out of print right away, et cetera. That's why you have to make time every day to study and to pay attention. Whatever you like, if you like the finger, then you learn everything about the finger because the finger will lead you to the rest of the body. Why? Because it's attached to it. So just studying the finger, eventually you'll get the rest of everything else. But choose one thing. If it's the hair, the eyelash, it will take you into the rest of the body, but you've got to pick a point and begin to really start knowing yourself. The Supermind, that's the name of this book, okay? And it was a very difficult book to get a hold of. I think I had to pay almost $80 to get one, okay, because you have to go to these book researchers that find lost and out-of-print books. But this is what she concluded, and all these things, in my experience, are true. This was published in 1979, yeah. Human beings have an innate biological awareness of their physical state down to the level of the single cell. Human beings can control the direction and flow of the nerve impulses throughout the body. Oh, yes, you can. The mind controls the physical activity of the brain. Okay, the brain doesn't control you. It's the mind that controls the brain, and you got to be clear about that. The brain will do what you tell it. Okay? Diseases originate in intellectual processes. Where do they originate from? They don't originate from outside of you. They originate where? In your mind, in intellectual processes. Stress has its effect on health because the rational mind confronts situations, especially social situations, with which it has decided it cannot cope. Okay? I say that if you tell yourself that you can cope with anything, guess what? You will, okay? So when you say you can't, well, then the body then has to say, okay, we can't go any further because we are told we can't. The potential is there. You can do anything. But if you say you can't, then the cells have to obey, okay? Human beings have evolved new sophisticated senses. One is an unconscious sense of order in which we anticipate the sequence of natural events and move from chaos toward unity. Will, your willfulness, your will is an independent function of your mind. Human beings have evolved elaborate mechanisms to ensure survival in an evolving psychological as well as physical environment. And the highest order intellectual capacities, elegant and sophisticated, reside in what we call the unconscious and may always reside there because they are unrecognized by the mother. Now, on the board, it says society, but I say the mother. Because if the mother is in tune with her subconscious mind, then she automatically brings forth literally a god or goddess in the children because they come with all of their DNA activated. So when she's willing to go there, that's what happens. Oh, I'm just moving my stuff over here. Okay, you got to see this. Now, let's understand about the mind. Very simple, okay? You inherit states of consciousness, no question about it, okay? Anything that your mother and father thought about continuously or believed, it is a chemical reality in the blood. It is then stored in your library known as your DNA. So you're automatically born thinking and being aware of those same predilections, okay? It's no problem because, again, if the parents are thinking thoughts that are not constructive or do not support where you want to go and what you want to do, you have two parameters that you can always change your inherited mindset. That is by having control over your home environment and education and experience. Okay, that will change, reinforce any mindset you want. Okay, and we have numerous examples of wonderful people that came from backgrounds that, you know, would seem almost impossible that they could be able to do the things that they did. But they navigated these two parameters and were able to have it like they wanted. It had nothing to do with what social science says and what the welfare determines is going to be. They navigated these two parameters. You can't change the base initially, but you can definitely transform it later. And that is how the will is supposed to be used. Okay, so education and experience and home environment. Now, I just got back from Asia to move closer into my dream of creating environments that are truly preventative. That is, that you cannot, in these environments that would be structured for you, get ill. And we recognize that by doing that and aligning environments, etc., with the energies that not only are predominant in your body, but in the environment that you're living in, that you can live, you can create a room, you can create a house that will reinforce your goals and your success. And that science is known as feng shui. Okay, and it was amazing that when I went to the Orient, the secrets that I was told as to how these individuals, that's the second parameter as to how the Japanese were able to come over here and do what they did in 40 years. It's also a second parameter as to how they were able to transform their bodies in such a short period of time, because they knew how to manipulate the home environment, and they knew what they needed to do wherever they go to set themselves up to have dominance over the energy in the space. Okay? This is an ancient art that all women used to know. That's why I'm very clear that a woman never had to learn how to read or write, because if she could read and write with nature, what else she need to know? What else does she need to know? That is the ultimate language that the sciences are still fumbling around with. But that was where we were always extremely competent, and we forsake that for a distorted geometry known as a language. Okay? So it's still the case where we see these individuals who are not, quote, learned, per se, in a language that we can read but accept can do magic in their own environment. Okay, because they actually can read nature. They can read this environment. Oh, so I do want you to know this, that also, too, your future is encoded in your DNA. So don't just think your genes just have information from the past. they also have encoded within them your future, okay? And they will naturally unfold if they are given the environment that does not bias them. Death and aging is not part of the library. These are abrupt, literally, a good descriptive word. It's even beyond an interruption. Okay, I mean, this is a temporary, literally that's what it is. It is a major temporary setback in your evolution. Okay, that's what that is, okay? Because the genes are always propelled for higher and higher and higher evolution. And this is one of the things that's really important, because I want you to hear me, is that even the stuff that's sprayed in the sky, the pollutions in the water, etc., why do we want to keep the sky cleaned up? Why do we want to keep the water available to us? Because we want to buy the time to adapt to the changes that are occurring on the planet. See, there's no changes that are occurring on the planet that you can't adapt to. You just got to give yourself the time to make the adaptation. So if you take bacteria, for example, I mean, if you take and, you know, flood them with a huge amount of antibiotics, yeah, there's going to be a certain number that's going to die because they didn't have the time to adapt. There's going to be a number that's going to be very weak, et cetera, and literally impotent momentarily, but they adapted fast enough to live. And then those same bacteria, given time, will then become super bacteria, and they will use the initial poison for food. Okay, and we're seeing that over and over again. So there's really no environment that you cannot master. You just have to put yourself in a state of wholesomeness that buys you the time to adapt. And now going back to our storyteller who's shining the light here, Einstein, the time is relative. And especially for humans, because if we say that we can adapt instantly, we will. If we say it takes us 10 years, then it will. If we say that we can't ever adapt, then we won't. So you have to remember that the relativeness of how you think is very important as to how fast or how slow you can make the transformations that you want. So remember that you didn't ask to become a full adult human. You didn't have to go to school to figure that out, etc. From the time that you were conceived, you actually transformed into a fetus and then into an infant, then to a child, then into an adolescent, into an adult. And you didn't have to partake in any of that. That was a given, right? So if all of that could happen spontaneously, then also the future you will also happen spontaneous. And the future you is not the direction of death and dying. It is not. Now, again, when we are indoctrinated with values and belief systems, which are chemicals, they will turn the genes off, or they will turn the genes on. And a good example of turning the genes on, for example, there's a gentleman who I know who came from a very, very depraved background. His mother, his father, he never knew his father. His mother had serious problems, and her lifestyle took her out of here by the time she was 35 years old. And he was literally left to raise himself. Now, in the environment that he was in, which was very, very minuscule as far as supporting an intellectual development, etc., he turned his own genes on and said that I am going to have my own publication company, I'm going to be a profound musician, etc., and literally taught himself, okay? So his will he used, again, to turn on the genes for what we all have, brilliance, capacity to learn, etc., irregardless of what was going on around him. Taking on belief systems about activities that you don't want to experience obviously will shut your genes off. And this is the conversation that I have with my patients who are critically ill. You know, you're coming to me to tell me that you want to live, well, then that's fine. And we can help you do that, but that's really stage by stage progress. Because the key here is that we want you to not just live and survive through this disease, we want you to be victorious in your life. And being victorious in your life means that you are not willing to accept that you can't have it for as long as you want and under the circumstances that you dictate. Which means then that you have to give up popular belief systems and popular experiences that other people expose themselves to. I definitely ask my patients if they can tell me why they have a need to believe in death and dying. I mean, I really want them to define it for me, because if each one of us are experiencing what we're experiencing, if these things that I'm telling you today are true, then we have to recognize that these are experiences that happen at our will. We are discovering that these are literally imprints that reside in where, as Baba Brown has said, in the subconscious mind, which means that if we want to overcome such a popular experience, we've got to be willing to go into the deeper areas of ourselves that usually is not entertained, and literally remove that value, because it is a chemical reality that is constantly being released into the bloodstream continuously. Do you understand that? And there are literal steps, just like you learn how to build a building, like you learn how to be able to read and write so that you can author a great manuscript, etc. There are stages that you go through, but your willingness to walk through those, to have your vision, you can have it. So I'm very clear here that, you know, to do what I need to do, I will be here for 200 years. I don't see the need to stay any longer. But for 200 years, I'll be here basically like I am, because everything I have right now, I need to have it to get done what I have to do. And you can will this for yourself. I mean, you have to understand that what I'm saying to you is no more ridiculous probably than what Henry Ford thought about when he decided to make a Model T and the Wright brothers to fly. Okay, but they did not allow the fact that even though everybody else had horses, or everybody else basically had buggies, to interfere with what it is that they saw for themselves. And you have to understand what I'm telling you here. If these individuals had not been devoted to the vision and understanding the truth about how life really works, you would not be able to go out in that parking lot today and get home in 10, 15 minutes or an hour or so. You would not, like myself, be able to get on a plane tomorrow night and fly 1,900 miles. Do you understand that? So you have to ask yourself, when someone approaches you and looking at your vested interest in an experience that you say you don't want to have, why don't you look? Okay? You know, I would really ask you to do that. It's very important. Now, interesting about our sensations in our body, because the body is created to have sensations. These are an acknowledgement of the cell's capacity to respond to the thoughts that you have inferred upon them, okay, or impressed upon them is a better word. And when they get it, they will send you a sensation. Now, emotions, however, are self-created, and they are quite different than sensations. And we are noticing that when individuals take upon themselves to create states of emotion, they do very interesting things to the DNA. DNA doesn't do well under most emotions, okay? So this is a very interesting study that just came out. this is a really profound study where they're talking about now the nature of emotions. And they started looking at more primitive animals and then actually looking at the responses to known environmental experiences, and then looking at what thought to a sensation will do. And for example, they said here, the stimulus event, for example, if there's a threat, the brain recognizes that it's danger, the feeling is a fear, the overt behavior is to escape, and the effect is to be safe. Okay? But now, all of the feeling states here really are what we call labels for an emotion, okay? Because normally in most animals, they don't have these states of what we call emotions. They immediately go from the cognition to the overt behavior and then accept the effect and then go back into their normal state. That's why they don't carry grudges. This is why they basically don't continue to wage war, etc., because they don't hold on to these emotions that are tagged to these thoughts that are tagged to a sensation. Very important to get that. So it's very interesting that this little cone here really looks like our chakras, or these points that Dr. Harrison talked about on the body. And for those people who have allowed that part of their brain to see, they actually look like this, like a flower petal that really is actually moving and spinning. And we do know that this eight-petal phenomenon is actually known as the universal flower, and there's a whole science around that. But as this spins, it does actually give off frequencies of the visual spectrum, which we call color. And it's very interesting that they have been able to elucidate that certain colors will actually evoke certain sensations in the body that in individuals who have thoughts that are connected to these sensations, they will then have these emotional states. So you have to understand it's like a really awesome gift, okay, because there are many ways that we can then transform this capacity to put yourself in states of feeling discomfort. Because when we talked about or introduced phototherapy, known as color therapy, etc., these colors actually do work on the subtle body to create chemistries that can allow you to feel comfortable, which means that the hormones or the neurotransmitters in the blood are actually in sync with what the cells are capable of doing relative to the normal programming of the DNA, or you can feel very irritated or agitated because that is your cells' response to letting you know that this is a reality that we are not programmed to have to master. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
Okay, that's why the previous charts that showed you, if it's something that's really dangerous for you, the natural response is to withdraw. But when you start putting on conclusions about these things, et cetera, then the cells will continuously give you this discomfort to let you know that this is something that we are not to master. So stress, very clearly, is a perception that an individual decides to have about an experience. Stress is a perception that an individual decides to have about an experience. Okay, you have to understand that people like, Evel Knievel, you know, he gets geeked up when he's getting ready to jump the Grand Canyon. Okay, that is really stimulating and fascinating to him. It's not fearful, you know, and because of that, that really propels his cells to make an energy vortex project out before him that gets him to the other side. You understand what I'm saying? He literally changes space and the electromagnetic field to create a vortex that allows him to get to the other side when we can't at all calculate how the motorbike could do that. Okay, because he transformed literal space to make a bridge for him because of the sensations in his body. Obviously, the person who is fearful, they actually repel space and they literally collapse between the bricks. They drop to their death. And I really think that you need to really understand and see this phenomena played out very accurately for you in the Matrix. Okay, I think it's really, you have to understand what's really happening here. So therefore, as we are growing and evolving, because you have to understand that who you think you are today is not your final destiny. And your DNA is constantly unfolding to have you evolve, et cetera, to become this master being that you've been created to be. As you move and walk into experiences that for the moment may seem new, etc., you don't understand and you decided it's stressful, then I just want to make a little recommendation for you so you can get over that and get control of your mind again and get in the right mind so that you can move forward. And that is the little 3 R's, okay? That first of all, you want to remove the stressor, okay, whatever it is. Okay, you want to then basically reduce the stress, okay, because normally it's something that you have done, et cetera, in the environment that has not been orderly, that has really caused chaos in your cells. And then the first thing that actually also will get rid of the chemistry of the perceived stress is to do the water. Okay. Usually anytime we have a stress over experience also too, I'll put that on there again, is that you want to re-educate yourself because obviously there was a misperception or lack of information that you proceeded on. okay, prematurely. But then that precious, precious substance, again, known as water, is critical because it will then dilute out and wash out the neurochemistry that was created by the stress. And when you are dehydrated and you are not drinking, et cetera, these neurotransmitters reside in the bloodstream much longer and allows you to have to then continuously respond to the illusion much longer. Okay? I have never really seen it that individuals who are really well, well hydrated be able to hold on to stressed perceptions very long. Can't be. Those individuals we know who are significantly depressed, psychotic, are definitely intrinsically dehydrated. And if they could be well hydrated, et cetera, they snap out of these illusional states right away. And this is something that the hospital actually does not do. Make sure that these individuals drink high quality water. So again, here we have a tribe of individuals in their homeland that do not perceive limitation, okay? They do not basically perceive the stress of having a trauma happen to them that would inhibit them from being whole. So this gentleman has been studying over the past 20 years this tribe in Africa that spontaneously regrows back legs and arms, feet and hands. And he sat there and documented this for the last 20 years. And these people don't read and write, they don't have PhDs, that kind of thing, etc. But they are very, very capable of allowing themselves to remain whole because they always see themselves that way. Now, this is something that is really the 100th monkey phenomenon now, because there was a wonderful woman that I read about in Detroit who was in a severe auto accident. She literally broke her neck, severed her spine, and was rendered in a coma. They knew that she wouldn't live through the night, but she did. They stabilized her and they flew her back from Arizona back to Michigan. And when she regained consciousness, they told her that she would never sit up again. She was a quadriplegic. Now, when I read about her, it was 9 years later, and she was in the newspaper being interviewed because she ran the 300-kilometer Windsor-Detroit fun run. There were 300 participants. She came in 300, but she was the one that was on the front page because she was the one that started out as a quadriplegic. A quadriplegic, did you hear me? With a broken neck, a quadriplegic, and in 9 years, she was running the fun run. And she was so humble, it was interesting. Her interview goes like this. They ask her, well, how do you feel? And she says, I feel fine. And she says, I was a little concerned about running the race because I still had a little numbness in my great toe and my right foot. So I asked my doctors if it would be okay if they thought this run would be fine. And they told me to go ahead. And I was like, of course they did. They better not say anything. Okay. But it was so interesting because they asked a physician, how could this be possible? Okay, that a person could actually sever their spinal cord and could move from a quadriplegic to now being able to run a 300-kilometer race. And he, in his very ignorant state, said to the writer that she was athletically inclined before her accident. She was never an amateur athlete. She was never a professional athlete. She just jogged. But as her story goes, she said that she never once saw herself not walking and moving. She said she never once not saw herself walking and moving. So if you have heard what I have shared with you today, then you understand that she never, from her own mind, interjected into her own bloodstream any neurochemistry that would shut down and interfere with the normal functioning of her cells. Her cells knew that they could make new brain tissue. I just showed you, they finally found that out, that we can grow new nerves. So, therefore, she did not allow the opinions, she did not allow the discussions and the belief systems of anyone else to interfere with her reality, and that was why she was on the front page of the newspaper. Do you understand that? So therefore, all of the athletes, whether they were skiers, whether they were swimmers, et cetera, that have had injuries, et cetera, and that still are tormented in their mind and are rolling around in a wheelchair, it's because of their mind. It is not because of their tissues. Do you understand that? And I'm saying that it's very important for us to really begin to study and understand how profound we are and to demand that we be serviced at the level that is competent to the divinity that we represent. The medical system now is continuously feeding you information about limitations, what can't be done, why you have to be segmented, why you have to have these things, instead of offering you what will bring you relief momentarily and then moving you into a circumstance that helps you understand how and why you created this issue so you can move on with your life. This is extremely important. If you understand then what I have shared with you, then you, unlike the individuals who will be shopping at these tissue re-engineering facilities, will not have to go that. You go there, you can take your money and do other things with it. Okay, because you will understand that because I can control my thoughts, because I understand how my brain works, my body will take care of itself. And I want you to understand, therefore, the whole discussion that's in the newspaper and on the news now is a farce, and it is a means of deviating large groups of people again from really understanding the real attributes of who they are and what the real discussion is about. Why are we not really sharing with the masses of the people the capacities that we know about their DNA, their mind, and their brain function so that they can actually regenerate their own tissues? We don't need embryonic stem cells, etc. We need a consciousness and an understanding of how we function so that we can move forward. Now, in the process of doing that, and you have to understand, I'm not opposed to the use of stem cell activity at all. But I am opposed to it if the individual then is not given the freedom to never have to have that experience again by giving him or her the information that they could do it all the time and from this point can. Does that make sense? Yes. So in summary, I want to say this, that we need to look at the subject that's at hand about our tissues. Is that all things will be possible through the science of human corporeal re-engineering because the tissue comes from a source that all possibilities were always present. Do you understand? If the source of the tissue has no limitation, then obviously they're not going to have limitation. Is that correct? Okay. The technologies developed in the sciences of human corporeal re-engineering are not extraordinary to the capacity of your own tissues. It is primarily the environmental conditions which the tissues are chronically exposed to that determine the capacity of the tissues to maintain their healthy state of existence. Each cell contains its complete necessary genetic complement to take care of any function the cell may require to sustain a state of health. Okay. Your blood and tissues are omnipotent, which means they have unlimited capacity and potentials. Your cells possess genetic programs to heal and regenerate themselves indefinitely. Science has demonstrated that the cellular environment that determines when genes are active or dormant. You have to understand, it's the cellular environment that determines when the gene is going to be active or when it's going to be dormant. Okay? Nutrition, environmental influences directly affect gene activity, but are not nearly as powerful and long-lasting as the neurochemicals made by the brain from your emotions. Okay? Emotions are neurochemicals made by the brain from complex thoughts and feeling associations. Okay? So you have to ask yourself, you know, if you slam your hand with a hammer, okay, it's just as much brain power to basically say, I need to pay better attention to this, or I knew I was sleepy and I had no business doing this and put the hammer down and come back to it when you know you're more efficient than to get upset and curse the hammer and whatever else. And because you have to understand that now you've went into a whole different chemistry. And when you take the attitude that, you know, I knew I was out of order, demanding something that I wasn't prepared to handle, okay, then you'll see that the response to that, the pain is almost gone instantly. Because you recognize what is happening, now you're going to take care of it appropriately, as opposed to going through an issue of projecting that the hammer was out of order or whatever else, etc. And it keeps you in chronic discomfort, okay? Now, the immune system is primarily affected by the neural, and excuse that spelling, that's N-E-U-R-O, chemistry made from states of emotion. Every chronic disease is chronic because of chronic states of emotion. And when these individuals can finally be shown how their thoughts and the sensations that are created by the thoughts can be changed, the chronic distortion in the tissues actually is ablated. It resolves. And you really know that. That's why people say, well, you know, when I had high blood pressure, they told me I was going to have a stroke. They had me on 6 medications, and I decided I would start meditating. And I haven't had any problems with my pressure since. But it's interesting what meditation does, because it actually is a means of allowing the brain to actually cleanse the bloodstream of its neurochemistry over the day. So if you've been very tense, even though that is still a perception that causes problems, you at least are going back at the end of the day and erasing the tense chemistry that wasn't absorbed by the cells, so you get relief. Does that make sense? Yeah. So, finally, it is the quality of emotional health of the individual which significantly influences the regeneration, healing, and immune capacities of the body. One, general health, capacity to heal, and potential to spontaneously regenerate are dominated by the individual's persistent state of consciousness. Water, 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 water is the common panacea to maintain tissue health, gene health, and to neutralize the effects of neurochemicals from the brain. Human tissue is innately, naturally immortal and is pre-programmed to spontaneously heal and regenerate. Okay, there are beings that are on this planet that are thousands of years old, just like it is trees. Okay, you have to understand that, you know, the creator I come from doesn't give a tree and endem it with more capacity than myself. It's just impossible. How could it be? If I can make planes and trains and all these things, a tree can't do any of that, and it can stay here 3,200 years. Well, obviously, that's a part of myself that I've shut down. And that's what you have to understand. It's not that you don't have the potential. You shut that down, and you have to ask yourself, why would I? Okay? The proper use of the brain via correct thinking is the key to ardent health and longevity. And the term I use, correct, is just relative, because correct is really defined by what it is your purpose in life. Okay, because there's some people who come here, they don't need to spend time on the planet a long time. But it's very clear that what they left here is so profound that they were very clear about what they came for, and they're out of here. Okay, so you have to be clear about what your purpose is, and being dedicated to that, then your cells will unfold that reality to you. Okay, and then finally note that the health and agelessness of the body will precisely demonstrate to its owner the degree of correctness or wholesomeness of your thoughts. Okay, and once we can actually get comfortable with that, then you can actually make vast changes in realigning and reactivating your DNA. Because if we stay in denial and we always want to rationalize why we're like this, why this happened, whatever else, etc., instead of letting the body be what it is for you, a barometer, okay, so that you can know directly where you need to go in your mind to realign it and get it right, then you'll basically not be allowed to activate the immortality gene. Got it? Okay. And you have to remember that if you do not use it, you lose it. And I think that that's the second time that's been said today. So there's another book that I want you to get a hold of that goes into more detail if you want to know more research about how we have been so neglectful about really making a standard as to how we're going to physically be handled. This is a great book called Body Bazaar. It gives you all the histories of how the tissues have been shunted and misused for all kind of research, et cetera, that you know nothing about. So again, for those of you who feel that you need to use the hospital system, I really ask you to go in as a magnificent divine being. Make it very clear to your physicians what you expect of them, that if you really say, I need a blood test for this, that, and the other, that I expect of you that it be used for that reason. I want it documented in the chart that you clearly understand that my blood is not to be used for any form of research activities in any manner without my consent. And if he or she will not document that in the chart for you, then that is a place you need not to further get services, because you probably are already involved in intense, heavy research without your information. And if a patient came to me and told me that, the first thing I would want to do is to be educated on why such a request would be made, because obviously they're bringing me a whole wealth of material that I didn't even know about, probably my own hospital system that I'm advocating. But you have to understand that this is the only way that you're going to be able to maintain some privacy around your organs and your DNA. Now, that doesn't ensure that it will not be stolen unless you decide and believe in yourself and recognize that you don't have to go there, because you always have that choice. And so obviously, if you don't go, then you don't have to worry about what they do, because they will not have any specimens. But then making that decision, you know that now that is a commitment to a lifestyle and a consciousness that allows you to be free from that. Is that right? Okay, thank you.
We have some questions and answers. Please don't go. There's another surprise for you. It's waiting for you, but let us have a few questions, please.
Dr. Einstein's case, at least his brain went to the pathologist's house. Okay, I'm sure they took many blood specimens, etc. And then that's part of the mortuary process, is that there's a whole process that they looped into the circulatory system, and they push the blood down the sewer, and the embalming fluid goes in. If they feel that they need to use it, then it's taken out at the time that the body is taken to the path lab in the hospital.
You stated that you can take from the saliva and grow new body parts. Is it necessary for Americans to have that done if you want new body parts to grow from us? Because of the trauma that happens?
Oh no, you have to understand that for many of us already, they probably have your blood on record. So they can basically just go to the storage base and get the cells that they need. Well, see, for as I understand it, it is much easier for melanated individuals to spontaneously regenerate. Well, because we do know that when the melanin content is lower, that to regenerate does take a longer period of time. And because of the issue of trauma from the environment versus rate of regeneration, that being able to use organs, okay, from someone else or their stem cells allows them to, quote, beat the clock. Does that make sense? Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Oh, thank you.
Yeah. We don't have two mics. Okay. Yes.
It's a pleasure to be in your presence.
Thank you.
What I would like to share with you, when you were talking about the incident where the lady that ran track was able to do that, she's a paraplegic. Yeah, she was in a wheelchair. Okay. Recently, my brother-in-law broke his neck, and he was put into the hospital, and they put the halo on him. Mm-hmm. And they asked us, and they had this weight where it was on the ground pulling his head in place. Mm-hmm. Well, it was so devastating and so painful that they wanted to give him morphine to deal with this, and telling him if he moved or anything like that, that, you know, he would die or it would paralyze him. Well, he couldn't stand the pain, and he had such a faith. He left the hospital. My husband went and picked him up and carried him home. And what we did was we encountered a holistic practitioner who worked with us and introduced to him certain calcium, magnesium in particular, and some other things that we did, and took the halo, the screws, I mean actual screws that were in his head out, all of that. Mm-hmm. Today he walks.
Thank you. So again, this sister shared with us the experience of your brother. Her brother-in-law that had a spinal cord injury, and obviously he fractured his neck, a vertebra in the neck, and they put him in what we call Vinky tongs, which is a means of actually a retraction of the spine so that supposedly the bone could grow back straight, etc. But as you've discovered, there's different ways of handling that.
And I saw the x-ray myself, so it was broken.
Yes, yes. So again, you know, it's great that someone else here can verify, okay, for you other than myself, that these things are real, and that we really ask you. This is a very important point in the evolution of each and every human being as to whether you're going to finally take on more of the properties of your God self, or are you going to continue to be a victim, okay? And there's a real high price to pay for not wanting to know more and to be in charge of the great gift that your God has given you. And you're really being asked to make a decision. So the arguments that you're seeing before you as though they're political and economic is really a genuine reflection of, are you going to be the God or Goddess, or are you just going to be a being, okay, to be led and manipulated? Yeah. I'm in Washington, D.C. Why did I say that? Oh, no, I'm not. I'm in Washington State. I said that so clear. Who's that talking? No. I'm in Washington State. I'm right outside of Seattle in Washington State. Okay. But we are really working on internet hookups and things like that. So, you know, I'm just really only a keyboard away. Okay. And so I have my cards here. And as a matter of fact, if somebody has a pencil, a marking pencil, I can put my email address up on the board, and you know, feel free to write me, give me a little time, etc. But you know, we will respond to you via email, etc. Yeah, like a marker, a magic marker. Yeah. Any more questions? Oh, good, they got it. Okay. Yes. Yeah. Okay. I'm gonna put it on the transparency. So will it work on a transparency? I don't think so. You have a marker, can I see? No, okay. Yeah, it's blue. Uh-huh. I can do two things at once. Question?
Okay.
Uh-huh.
Oftentimes, their children are made, their child is made to stay in the hospital while the mother is allowed to go home. And there's always some question about maybe the child defecating when the mother or something happened.
Oh,
That's just one thing. There's always some kind of excuse. And I hear mothers, because sometimes I'm talking with them and they're wondering, is there anything that is more going on with what they said? Like maybe doing research or whatever, taking maybe blood or tissue.
they're probably doing all of the above.
But I will say this, that there's nobody that's a victim, and I'm really, really big on a preventative lifestyle. And one of the things that makes such a difference for a mother is if she's never eaten well in her life, to really eat well and live well when she's pregnant. Because that way we don't have children that have meconium stain, amniotic fluid. That's one of the reasons why. That is very acid. And when that is inhaled by the fetus, it goes into the lungs. It creates literally a burn state. So they don't have the space they need to exchange oxygen on the blood cell. So their oxygen count is down in the blood. It can cause birth defects. They can have other lung diseases. And the meconium staining comes from the environment that the mother exposed herself to while she was pregnant. So as many home deliveries as I have done, if the mother eats well and really understands what she needs to do in navigating her environment while she's pregnant, because many parameters change as far as sound is amplified 7 times, so she has to be very careful about sound. She has to have a different relationship with water. She has to have a different relationship with how she rests her body, her nutrients, so that this baby doesn't take all of her minerals out of her body. All those things shift. And when that's not attended to, then these are the things that you see at delivery. I can tell you that my most uncomfortable experience in my medical career was obstetrics in the hospital, because I had to deal with so many complications, so many birth defects. I had to deal with all of these things that obviously all of this was done before I sat down on the stool to deliver them. So it wasn't much that I could alter in that situation except do the best I could, and a mother had to take home a problem. Okay, it's not fun to take home a problem. Do you understand what I'm saying? But this can be abated when the mother really understands what a sacred gift this is to allow another soul to come into this dimension and honor that. So I'm saying that, yes, these things are happening, but also, too, the mother's lifestyle also set the individual up to have those experiences. So there's still no victims, and obviously the little souls that have to go through that also need to learn something from that. So it's a bigger issue, and we can talk about the metaphysics of experiences at another time. That's an interesting lecture, though. Okay. Yeah. Oh, okay. Well, I'm going to let you handle this. But can everybody read that? Okay. Yeah. Yes. 2 more questions. Mm-hmm. Yes. Did you ask a question already? Oh, okay.
Why is it such a need to clone a human being?
Again, because we have a species of beings on the planet, as I tell you, that they really don't heal very well, very fast. And they like to be here too, okay? They do. And I'm saying this, which I think is very interesting, because my studies lead me to know that even though these individuals really appear to be more traumatized than others with the environment, that also is due to their state of consciousness. And I have seen that when they basically purify their thoughts and change their state of consciousness, their longevity is just as long as anyone else's. So many times, and it's been written about, that there are groups of people that seem to be more violent, that seem to be more exploitive, okay, that seem to be much more territorial and aggressive. To have those kind of emotional states, as we've shown on the board, has neurochemistry that shuts down genes. So when they're willing to give up those kind of attitudes, which are based on perceptions of reality, then they can be here just as long as anybody else. The key is, and again, this is why I feel my work with women is so important worldwide, is that when the woman really begins to embrace the abundance of this dimension and recognizes that she's not here stranded, that she's not here to bring life to other people and not have the support she needs, then she won't inherently raise children to be aggressive and to be dominating and to be so willing to take advantage of what appears to be a weaker being for its own survival. But see, that only can come about innately if the mother will embrace the truth about this dimension, which is that abundance is the natural state of affairs. Do you understand? Yeah. Yeah.
Good evening, Dr. Pookrum.
Yes.
I don't know if you can see this far in the dark, I want to give a brief testimony. If I may, I was your patient back when I lived in Lorain, Ohio, and had endometriosis, and you cured me of endometriosis.
No, you cured yourself. Yeah,
okay.
Okay. I just talked to you. Okay.
Mm-hmm. And my son, who ended up getting, I won't go into it, but let me ask you this.
Mm-hmm.
You have skills and information. Dr. Harrison has skills and mm-hmm. information. Is there some plan to create a perfect health care system where we can access your services, your guidance, even though you're in Washington now?
Sure. No question. You're reading my mind.
Oh,
of course.
Good.
Yeah.
Good. See, it's working. Still.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And that's why I'm saying that. You know, this is one of the great gifts, as far as I'm concerned, that the internet is given to me, is the capacity that our services can be accessed from anywhere in the world. Okay. So, you know, just keep tuned. Okay. And you'll be able to be hooked into that system. Okay. Great. Is that it? Thank you.
I really want to show our appreciation for Dr. G.